How powerful is the mind actually? It's really, this is a great question. If we think about, let me think about a, like a gymnast, like a superstar athlete. How much can you really train your body, your muscles, your flexibility, your tendons and ligaments? Well, we see that some people can do incredible feats. Then if you transfer that same kind of questioning to the mind, how far can we really strengthen or extend basic capacities? For example, emotion awareness. How refined can I feel and notice moment to moment emotion experience? Or attentional abilities, of which there are many different kinds of attention. Or even the ability to observe and notice others. And sense others. And based on both experience and research and also working with people who've done that work of training their minds over 10, 20, 30, 40 years, it appears that we have much more capacity to refine our innate, our basic abilities than we currently believe. Lifelong, we influence in the same way that, you know, if you think about going to the gym, you can build muscle strength and flexibility. Likewise, we actually have access to lots of ways of training the body and the mind that begin to influence the strength of the brain signal, its relationship to other brain parts, and how networks interact. And that's across the entire lifespan. And so the power of the mind to experience pain, to reformulate our relationship to pain, for example, or to sensation, is pretty powerful. I'll give you one simple practice or idea. You know, I can have physical pain, of which, you know, millions or billions of people do, but can I use my mind to reappraise, to imbue that the experience of pain to make it meaningful? For example, may I experience this physical pain or emotional pain so that someone else be free? And suddenly that pain has a different meaning. And I relate to the pain differently, not because the pain itself has changed, but something in my mind about relationship has shifted. So neuroplasticity is something that's probably been around as a concept about the flexibility of the brain for 30, 40 years, depending if you think about animal research and to human research. But essentially, it's the idea that's derived from thousands of studies that what I choose to do every day, eat, drink, exercise, hug someone, or be isolated or be socially interconnected, literally influences both the anatomy and the function in my brain. And more specifically, for example, if we think about somebody, if I asked you to juggle for the next 3 weeks, hours per day, then the manual dexterity that you begin to develop actually manifests as more gray matter cells in the areas of the brain that are for sensory and motor hand control. So that's one example. If you're a violinist, for example, you might develop finger dexterity, and that really begins to show how brain activity and brain matter change in the areas that are related to fingers. And likewise, what we do, like we literally sculpt and shape not only our prefrontal cortex, but our entire brain networks by how we read, think, sleep, eat, which suggests that from one perspective, we are the architects of our own brain. Of course, yes, we're born with a brain that's influenced by the genetics of our parents and previous generations, but we have incredible architectural relationship to sculpting our brain function, how different parts of the brain communicate to each other. And that suggests that's a manifestation of plasticity, that it's not a fixed physical entity and that it can be modified, which brings a lot of hope for a person who might think something's wrong with my brain or I have a fixed notion of who I am or what material I am. Tonglen, for example, as you mentioned, this idea of taking on someone's suffering and then out of one's own understanding of emptiness and compassion, sending forth well-being to others. There's only one published study, empirical. I just looked at this last week for cancer survivors. Having said that, I know there are other research teams that are trying to start looking at this. Other practices of mindfulness, there's more research for compassion, a little bit, but this is a brand new, exciting time where many other more specific kinds of practices are now becoming, entering into the West, and specifically Western science, that now are the purview of research and investigation.